Iñaki, tell us all about mediasoup, please.
Okay, so thanks a lot, Saul, for introducing me. So okay, I'm going to speak about mediasoup. So in short, mediasoup is a multi-party video conferencing system for Node, which is designed to work with WebRTC endpoints, maybe browsers, maybe mobile applications. And it's designed in a way that is not a common server as we may know, but instead is a Node library, something I will explain later in more detail. So at the beginning, I'm going to speak about different multi-conference topologies. There are some of them, and I will explain, I think there are three. The first one is called Full Mesh, and this is a very funny and very interesting multi-conference topology, because as you can see, there is no media server. Of course, there is a signaling server somewhere, because there must be a way to make all the participants agree on having a room. But that's something about signaling. When it comes to the media plane, I mean processing, receiving, sending the media packets, in this topology there is no a media server. So it's funny for that, because you don't need a media server, but it doesn't scale very well. As you can see in the picture, each participant must send all his streams, audio and video, to all the other participants, which means a high uplink bandwidth requirement, which is not good for clients. Then we have a better solution, which is a bit legacy right now, but it works. It works very well. It's the MCU. In this case, there is a central server, a media server, which does a lot of work, in the sense that it receives all the media streams from the participants, let it be audio, microphone audio, and video from the webcam. The media server, the MCU, mixes all of them into a single new stream and sends it back to all the other participants. So each participant sends one and receives one. This is okay from the client point of view, in the sense that there is a low bandwidth requirement. And it's very easy to deal with just a single remote stream, but it doesn't let the application build interesting or cool things in the layout, because you just receive a video, and if you know how to draw a video element in a web application, you know that a video is just a container and you cannot split it into multiple pieces. So, well, it's simple, it works, but we can do it better. The SFU, Jitsi, is also SFU. So in this case, in this topology, there is a central server. It receives all the streams from all the participants, but instead of processing them, instead of decoding, mixing, and encoding into a new single stream, it just behaves like a packet router for all the RTP packets coming to the server from the participants. So at the end, one participant sends one and receives many. Okay, from the uplink point of view, this is okay, because each participant must upload just a single stream. And for the downlink, its browser in this case much receives a lot of streams, but usually the downlink is better than the uplink, so that shouldn't be a problem. From the layout perspective, I mean, from how the UI application will look, this is nice, because the client will receive separate streams, so it can display them in any kind of fashion. Well, as expected, mediasoup is SFU, so let's see how it works. Okay, first demo. Please connect to the FOSDEM Wi-Fi network. I mean, just IPv6. Please, it's running. The server is running in my laptop. It's running in the IPv6 network. And just in my case, I don't know, but just for example, in my case, I had to disable the IPv4 network in order for it to connect to the internet. So. Okay. So just make sure that you have internet access to Google or whatever, and then just please join that. Well, not yet, because I am going to run the server.
Oh, that's why.
Oh. Okay. I ran out of time already, so it's enough. You can see, sorry. So you can see how each remote participant is displayed into a different container of video, so you can place them in any kind of fashion within your web application. Okay, so coming back to what mediasoup is. One of my goals when I decide to build this media server is to make it minimalist. What does it mean? Well, it means that mediasoup is not a common server. It's not a full application. It's not something that provides you with an init script or even a configuration file. Instead of that, mediasoup is just API-driven by JavaScript. So it just focuses on the media plane, which means it does not provide you with a signaling protocol such as SIP, XMPP, any kind of custom protocol over WebSocket or whichever. It's up to the application, it's up to the developer integrating mediasoup into its application to decide how to signal message from clients, browsers to others. So, at the end, mediasoup is just a node module. And you all know what a node module is. It's something that you add into your bigger node application. It's just a dependency into your application, like many others. You may want to build a real-time application and you have Express, so you have HTTP server, and you can add socket.io, so you have a chat room, and then you can add mediasoup into it, so you can provide your application with multi-party video conferencing. So in order to install it, it's just as any other node library, just an npm install mediasoup, and that's all. Well, it's a node library or node module, so it must provide us with a JavaScript API. So this is how it looks. Basically, here we are loading the mediasoup module within our bigger node application, running in the server, of course. We are creating a server. When we create a server, we instruct mediasoup to launch some sub-processes that run, they are written in C++, and they are separate processes that manage the media layer, okay? So then we are gonna create a media room with some specific codecs. In this case, we use Opus for audio and BPH for video. Then we create the room and the party can start. So now it's time to add participants into the room. For this task, mediasoup provides the application or the developer with two different kinds of APIs. Allow level one, which is based on ORTC. ORTC is a specification that tries to accomplish with the same goal than WebRTC, but at a very low level API. So this is how mediasoup internals work. This is a very low level API that lets you create all the components of the communication by you, just by creating them separately. You can create a transport, you can create a receiver to receive audio from the browser, whatever. But it happens that browsers speak WebRTC, no ORTC. So browsers deal with SDP blobs. They generate SDP blobs and they consume SDP blobs. So we must deal with that. So mediasoup provides with a high level API that in fact uses the low level API inside, but and this API is exactly the same as the WebRTC API. This is peer connection, create offers, set local description, all of that. Well, mediasoup just forwards the media. This is not new. I mean, it does not provide you with a signaling protocol, nothing like that. And when it comes to forward media, this is how the mediasoup worker, which is the sub-process handling the media, looks like. You can see that here we have a room with three browsers. All of them, for every browser joining this room, there is a peer instance within the mediasoup room. Each peer instance manages its own transport and receiver and senders in order to receive media streams from the browsers and send audio and video to them. And okay, this is how the mediasoup provide WebRTC JavaScript API looks. If you are familiar with the WebRTC API in browsers, you will know what this is about because the API is exactly the same. So the party starts when a participant wishes to join a room. So the application in server side must create an offer, for him, get an SDP offer, and send the offer to the client, to the remote client, maybe a browser or whichever. How to do that is up to the application. You can use SIP protocol over WebSockets by using JSSIP, for example. You can use XMPP, you can use whichever way, whichever mechanisms you wish to communicate with your browsers. So suddenly you will receive an answer, a SDP answer from the client. And eventually new participants will join the room. So when that happens, all the others will get an event, a negotiation need event. So the application, who is listening for that event, will call again, create offer, and set remote description. So the browser receives a new description, a new SDP, telling him about all the remote streams that it must manage. So suddenly, on that stream, events will happen in the browser. So the browser will be able to display the video of the new participants. Well, this is like before. In this case, there is a room with six participants. And well, you can see that the CPU usage is not very. Well, it's okay, no? I think it's running in my computer, so I don't know how it would be in a server, but well, it looks okay. Well, we are speaking about multi. Okay, thank you. It's not mine, but we're speaking about multi-streaming stuff. So, how do browsers behave when it comes to multi-streaming? Okay, it happens that. Unfortunately, Chrome still implements his own specification on how to deal with multiple streams. At the same time, Firefox implements the new specification, the standard. So this is a mix of different things that it's very difficult to manage. The good news are that mediasoup does that, supports both of them. So you don't have to worry about this. Well, something about the roadmap of mediasoup. The first version is really close. My friend, also José Luis Millán, in there is working on implementing the Google congestion control protocol into mediasoup so the video can be smoother than right now. Also some stuff about the WebRTC provided API. And for a second version, funny things will be done, such as implementing simulcast and SVC codecs, which Saul already explained before, so I'm not going to enter into details. Well, the point is that, for example, I mean, Saul has shown us the Jitsi application. Well, that's a full application in the sense that it provides you with a complete tool of a server, a web interface, the client side, server side. It's an application for meetings, so for something like that. The point of mediasoup is that it's not a full application. It is just a, a library, a server-side library for Node. So you must integrate it into your own application, and you must decide what to do. I mean, you may wish to build yet another multi-conference application for enterprise. You may wish to do something social for people to meet other people. I don't know. So I have done that, yet another application. Well, okay, I have 5 minutes. Okay, I just need 2. Okay, in this case, well, I will show it. So please just reload the browser. No, not yet. I must change. Okay, people is joining. Hey. More people, please. We need to meet ourselves. Okay. Sorry? Ah, okay. Can you see it? It's okay.
Yeah.
Does it work? But can you?
Yeah, object can not be found.
Ah, sometimes in mobile, well, just a demo. Okay, so for example, this is an application. Hey. Saul sent me a like. So we can see one to each other, but we cannot talk or listen one to each other yet. But hey.
Hello.
Hey. Oh, I don't like your voice. Sorry. So well. So well, that's all. So thanks a lot. If you have any question.
We've got 3 minutes for questions.
Okay. Bueno, Saul.
What's the gap for server-side recording and export to RTP or RTP?
Well, in fact, okay. He's asking me about capability of mediasoup to record the streams in server-side, for example. Okay, in fact, mediasoup already provides the application with an API to receive a raw RTP packets in JavaScript LAM, so you can manage them as you wish. You can save them into a database. I don't know. So that's for now the API, the provided API.
How about RTC key handling? What do you do with RTC?
RTC.
Yeah. And the second question: why do you create the first offer from the server and not from the client?
Yes. Okay. Okay, first one is about, he's asking me about what mediasoup does with RTCP processing. Okay, currently that's something that Jose Luis Millán is working on. He's the RTCP guy on this, but okay, we now generate the receiving reports, we forward send the reports, we manage NAC, we have a RTP buffer, so if we receive a NAC from a receiver, we resend it. And the most important thing is a congestion protocol that is not yet implemented. So he's working on this right now. And the second question was, sorry?
Why do you create the first offer from
okay. Okay, that's, for me, is a very interesting question because I spent 6 months doing the opposite until I realized of my error and changed 2 weeks ago. Okay, so the question is that if you create the offer in the server, you manage which payload types and everything the others will need to use instead of letting them choose them. So you don't have to keep a mapping of payload types and nothing like that. In fact, you create the offer, you own it, and you own the session. It's really fucking easier in that way.
All right. Thanks, Iñaki.
Okay. Right. Thank you.